I am making a gigantic assumption here today that all of you had a safe, sane, and sober New Year's Eve, right? All right, good, good, good. Great to see you. Long Tank, you slept in this morning. Your spot was empty in the 8 o'clock. I never see him except 8 o'clock service, dear man. Got me by surprise. Good morning. If you are visiting New Hope, I would never do that to you, what I just did to him. But I've known him since the 7th grade, all right? Well, I was in the 7th grade. He's much older than I am. But anyway, welcome. It's great to have you visiting with us. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. Love for you to fill one out and drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. We promise not to be an irritant to you, but through the mail we will send some information we hope answers most of your questions about what goes on around New Hope. And maybe you'll want to investigate some of those other opportunities that are here. Just out of curiosity, how many of you were awake when the new year rolled in this past week? Look, oh, good, 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 good. How many of you were not awake? All right, about 50-50. In the 8 o'clock service, it was like 90-10, okay? All right, it's like 90-10. And the 10% that were awake, I asked him, I said, were you legitimately awake or did you just have to get up to the bathroom, all right? And that took about another 5% away, okay? So I was a bad man, but I was awake, and then about 5 minutes early, knuckleheads in our neighborhood started shooting off fireworks and I think a few shotguns. And my dog did not enjoy that at midnight. And so so he and I sat up and watched NCIS as the new year came in. But anyway, welcome. It's great to have you here at New Hope at the beginning of this new year. Thank you for helping us to start the new year right. We are honored to have you with us. Let me highlight a few announcements. Guys, this is a book of all bulletins that you should read, okay, the first one of the year. And the reason is so little has gone on around the church except on Sundays for the last 2 weeks, and everything is gearing up, all right, over the next 2 weeks. So if you want to know what's happening without me taking forever to read it to you, read the bulletin. I am going to highlight just a few of the things, but for more information, read it. And that is this afternoon at 12:30 over in the bridge. There is the first parent meeting. If you have a high school student and you would be interested in your student going to Mexico for a week, then you need to go to that meeting. All right, you're a grandparent. You'd love for your grandkid to go. We do bring them back. Okay, we have never left one there. That ticked off a few parents, but overall, they're happy to see them come back. It's a great, great trip. It's eye-opening. It's life-changing oftentimes for some of these kids who've never been out of the central San Joaquin Valley. So that meeting will be today at 12:30. It's the first of a couple. Hope Group Year at a Glance, a special Sunday night service next Sunday night at 6 o'clock right here in this room, I believe. And there's going to be some music and some testimonies. If you are part of a small group, they want you to come that night, all right? And share what were some good things that happened for you this year as a result of your small group. What were some service projects that your small group did? Personally, how did the members of your small group make a difference in your life? So we want to hear that. There'll be some folks joining us that night who've said we want to join a small group, we think. And what's going to help them make up their mind is hearing your testimony. So come join us next Sunday evening at 6 o'clock, all right? This coming Thursday morning, 6 a.m., this is for you early riser guys, all right? 6 to 6:45 in the morning. We have a men's Bible study meets over in the office building. And we usually have 20, 25 guys. We're going to start a brand new study kicking off this year. It's called Fight, Winning the Battles That Matter Most. And so love to see you at 6 a.m. It's over right at 6:45. For you retirement guys, that means you can get to McDonald's with the rest of the crowd. For those of you who are still employed, it means that you can take off and get to work before your starting time. And so we start promptly and we end promptly on that particular Bible study. Not this Tuesday night, but a week from this Tuesday night, both our men's and our women's Bible studies will be kicking off. And for the women, they would love for you to sign up. There are two sign-up sheets on this. One of them is for the women's Tuesday night Bible study. The other is for the Wednesday evening parent study. So make sure you're signing up for the right one. They want to know so they have enough material there. Oh, and the Wednesday morning Bible study. Okay. All right. Tuesday night, Wednesday morning. That's all next, not this week, but the following week. Okay. Thank you, Miss Fawn. Raising Kingdom Kids is a Wednesday night Bible study that's going to start on January the 13th. It'll be every Wednesday night through February 24th. It coincides with when you drop your kids off to our JAMS Kids program, and they're going to be studying biblical kings and queens during that time period. Corey Gallardo is going to be facilitating a Bible study called Raising Kingdom Kids. It's a class on parenting, and that's on the sign-up sheet coming around. I think I have covered all of the Bible studies that are going to be starting over the next couple of weeks. Let me highlight a few prayer requests that were sent to me in just the last 48 hours. One, actually about 5:30 this morning, was to pray for a young man named Caleb. New Year's Eve is a challenging time for folks who have had substance abuse issues. The week of New Year's is one of the toughest weeks of the year. And there's a young man who lost his sobriety during this week and called in, wanted prayer. So just ask you to remember, all I'm going to tell you is Caleb. So just remember to pray for Caleb. I had a prayer request yesterday from the Boitano family. Good friends of theirs, Danny and this dad have coached baseball together. It's the Rocco Rossini family. Their 9-year-old son this week was playing on an ATV, driving around, and there was an accident, and he died. And so I want you to pray for the Rossini family. This is a very, very challenging time for them. Pray for the Boitanos as God uses them with care and comfort in their lives. The Angelich family, which also happens to be Susan Boitano's family. She was an Angelich before she became a Boitano. Actually, you've been a Boitano a lot longer now than you've been an Angelich, huh? But anyway, I believe it's your great aunt, your cousin's grandmother, passed away, 96, if my memory's working correctly, 96. Or, oh, 101. Oh, my goodness. I think I've only done one other centurion memorial service, so it'll be number 2 now, all right? But anyway, she passed away this week, and those services are getting scheduled this coming week. They're pending right now. And then the Zanders family, any Hoover people from the 70s, okay? Jack Zanders. Jack Zanders passed away this week, and he's a year older than me. Jack was about 5'6", maybe 5'7" at the most, broad in the shoulders, kind of narrow in the hips, and he was a thug. Am I telling the truth? He was a thug, all right? Not much other way I could say it in high school, he was a thug. But somehow, Jack Zanders and I got along well in high school, all right? But he really was. He was just one tough guy. He'd rather fight you than talk to you. And I did not see Jack for years, about 12 years out of high school. He walks into the Bible house where I was working. And I looked at Jack and I said, Jack, I got to be honest, you are the last person on the face of this earth I ever thought I would see walking into this store. He said, Tim, I got to tell you, I got saved. I said, Jack, how'd that happen? I tried, you know, but yeah, it was tough. And he said, well, just I've made a lot of bad decisions in my life. I said, Jack, you'd done that before the 12th grade, man. And he said, no, I have. He said, but you know what? He said, I've had an employer who's cared about me. And some of you will know his employer. His employer was Bobby Wilbanks, who had Fresno House Moving. And Bobby's a Christian, and over the years, poured it. So anyway, I got a call from Jack's daughter this week. His daughter's probably in her 40s. And said, you and I have never met, but Dad had a file. And he said, whenever I die, the directions for my service in that file. And it said, your name was at the top of the list. Contact this guy. He's to do my funeral. And here's a letter. It's sealed. We were told not to open it. I haven't seen the letter yet. I can't wait to see what's in that letter. But anyway, that service will get scheduled sometime in the next 2 weeks. But just want you to pray for the Zanders family. And I am so grateful that he did find the Lord, all right, before this moment came. So I'm very grateful for that. So those are just a few of the updates. Shelley wanted me to be sure to share with all of you how much she appreciates your phone calls, the messages you've left, the texts, the emails. Church in the house. She's so grateful for all the comfort that's come from that. Her mother's service is tonight and tomorrow. None of you ever probably had a chance to meet Betty. Did I get it over here? I'll show you a picture. That was my mother-in-law. That's Shelley's mom, all right? And she was a softball coach and a tennis coach at Central Catholic High in Turlock. For those of you who know much about sports, Central Catholic has just won its fourth state championship in football in a row, and that makes something like 20-some-odd in the last 40 years, all right? So it was a pretty big sports school, but she taught there. And when Shelley's twin brother, Scott, died at 16, coming home from a football game, there was a chaplain, a Catholic chaplain, a priest, at Central Catholic High who did their service. He had a great sense of humor, wonderful character. And so Betty had always said for 40 years, whenever I die, I want the same Father Tom who did Scott's service to do my service. Well, Father Tom moved out of the area. He is no longer a father. He's actually a father now. Father Tom moved down to Hollywood area and met a delightful lady, and he fell in love. And so he left the priesthood and entered into marriage and has five children, all right? And he then became a hospice chaplain in Santa Barbara, and then for the last 20 years in South Bend, Indiana. Literally, he's right next door to Notre Dame, all right? And so we tracked him down. We found him, and he got out of town yesterday. So tonight there is a rosary in Turlock, and tomorrow will be the service also at Turlock Memorial Park. So thank you for your thoughts and your prayers. And it's really somewhat humorous. Tom is a great guy. He and I have been corresponding and talking for the last 3 or 4 days. Very personable, very outgoing, very gregarious. And what's somewhat funny about this is Betty was the only one who still had any Catholic roots in the whole family. All the rest of them, and this is the no reflection, but all the rest of them in different ways became Baptists, okay? And fortunately, also Christians, not just Baptists, but they became Christians as well. And that was pretty exciting. Betty knew the Lord as well. She wasn't just Catholic. She also knew Jesus Christ. And so that's exciting. So just be praying. But Shelley's so appreciative of all the outpouring of love that she's had. So thank you so very much for that. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. And if you were visiting with us, sorry to kind of be so long, but it's the beginning of a year. Lots gone on, and again, I usually talk about my own family that much, but Shelley lost her dad only 112 days before her mom died. So very, very close together, and you all as a church family have just been wonderful. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we love you. And we thank you for the gracious desire that you have to hang out with us. In fact, Father, on this stage for the last 5 weeks had been in gigantic words in the opening of the baptistry, God with us. For that is the meaning of one of the names given to Christ, Emmanuel. You didn't just want us to die and come to heaven. But Father, you wanted us to be born again on earth so that in our days, our weeks, our years, our decades here, we could share life with you and then spend eternity in heaven. And Father, I pray that none of us take lightly the desire of your heart to hang out with us here. Father, you hang out with us with a purpose. And your purpose is that daily we will be conformed to the image of your Son. Just as Shelley and her twin brother, Scott, looked a lot alike. Now that I have become your child, I'm now a joint heir with Jesus Christ. I'm part of your family. I need to resemble my father and my brother. And so, God, you desire in the process of hanging out with us to give us your strength, to give us your spirit, to give to us your character. And in growing measure, we become more and more and more like you. May we never, ever take that lightly or for granted. Father, thank you for the way in which you have, in our tough moments this past year, you have met our needs. As we walk through the valley of the shadow of death with others, you provided strength. As you walked through our own valley of the shadow, you were present. And so today we look back and we say thanks. And today we look forward and we say thanks. Because the God who's been the God of our past, we know, is the God of our future. We trust you with the needs that have been shared today. Father, for the family who's just lost their 9-year-old. This is a tough, harsh world we live in. And accidents happen, Father, and hurts mount up. Father, for a young man who, by no accident, but by willful choice, stepped out of sobriety and back into use. We pray, Father, this is a momentary blip and that he realizes and recovers. Father, we pray for those in need of comfort because of death, the Zanders family and the Ladd family, the others we've mentioned. Father, for the privilege of giving and sharing, it's a matter of trust as we give, that we trust you with our needs and we give to you first. But we do that on this first day of the year. We commit all this to you in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Thanks, guys. Mark Addis, I think I saw you in this. Mark, would you stand, please? Mark Addis. I want you all to give a New Hope greeting and say, Pastor Mark. He started January 1, and he actually showed up at the office, all right, on January 1. It was really rather amazing. So we're excited about that, and you'll be seeing and hearing more from Mark in the next few weeks. But as you know, at the beginning of the year, he came on as part of our part-time pastoral staff. So we're excited about that. I passed out a slip of paper during the offering. Just hold on to that for a few minutes. I'll give some direction to it in a little bit. I'm not collecting them. This is strictly for you. If you want to engage in that part of the sermon, using that little strip of paper, we'll explain that more in just a moment. I did realize in preparing for today's sermon that it was going to be maybe in your face. I had a guy in the 8 o'clock service come up to me and said, Pastor, you got in my grill this morning. That was not my intent, all right? But so be it, I guess. So just giving you a little heads up as we talk about some things as we kick off 2016. Don't we all love a new car? I mean, even if it's not mine, I love getting in somebody. In fact, I prefer when it's not mine, all right, to get into somebody's new car. How about a new home? Wow, this is so cool. Just got a text message from Chad and Katie. By the way, no beau yet, all right, no grandson. But they put an offer in on a house on Saturday, all right? So I guess they're staying in Tennessee. But I got excited, man. They see, you know, a little Zillow, or is that what it's called? Zillow, you know, put 28 pictures, you know, got to look at it. That was cool. New clothes. In fact, some of you are wearing some today, all right? You got it Christmas, all right? I can tell. They're new. It's good. We like new clothes, all right? New job, okay? I haven't had one in 32 years, but new jobs are always kind of, you know, I understand, kind of fun. There's something fresh when that three-letter word is on the front end in there. New. There's just something really fresh about that. And where my thoughts went this week is I wonder if we really realize that every morning we wake up and our feet hit the floor, it's a new day. It's a fresh start. This day is a new beginning. It's a day that's never been worn. It's never been traced on. It's not been walked through. This day has not been used yet. It's kind of like a baby's bottom. I'm getting ready to become a grandparent, so I've got all these visions, all right? But it's kind of like a baby's bottom, fresh out of the womb. It's never been wiped, powdered, or probed. And the doctor can't wait to give it a swat, all right? He's just really juiced about this thing. And that's the way we ought to face every day. And January 1st is perhaps the best of the new days, because that day marks the beginning not only of a new day, but a brand new year. And it's a time that all of us all of us, whether we like New Year's resolutions or not, it's a time that we think about the past and we want to put it away. Shelley is chomping at the bit to get Christmas put away at our house. Okay, normally for the last 7 years at the Roland house, Christmas Day about 4 o'clock, okay, 95% of Christmas is gone. It's put away, all right? This year, because her mom died on Christmas Day, she came home one day and she said, I said, no, you're not, babe. I said, it'll wait a week. She said, but it's just driving. I said, babe, just chill, relax. We got other things. You have other things that are more important than that. She said, well, why can't I? I said, because I'm not getting the boxes out of the barn, okay? So we're not, we have other things. But there's something about a new year that we like to put away the old. We want to start new. Even if we don't like resolutions, we begin to think how to begin the dawning day of a new year better than we ended the final day of an old year. It seems to me that our resolutions, and if you don't like that word, how about our determinations? If that's still a little strong, how about our intentions? Or how about just our thoughts? But they all seem to center around two words. Less, more, don't they? Think with me through this a minute. Less debt, more savings. Didn't you give some thought to that already? Huh? As you start this new year, didn't that where part of your head goes? How about, okay, this is the number one resolution. Less weight, more shape. Okay? I got an uncle in Shafter, he says, Tim, round is a shape. And then he illustrates it for me. He says, look, I never have to iron my shirts, okay? You just put them over, it stretches all the wrinkles right out, all right? And he's right, it does, all right? And then he says, Tim, he's 71 now, all right? He's a guy that I bird hunt with when I get a chance to bird hunt. And he said, Tim, look at his face. He said, I look at all my skinny friends that are my age or older. He said, they got wrinkled. He said, look, this is baby. He said, when I see a wrinkle pop up, I just go to the donut store. Right? He said, man, it just smooths those out. So, and you know what I hate about him? His cholesterol's 102. Okay? But less weight, more shape. Less sickness, more health. Less clutter. How many of you have already been either to the dump or you've made trips to PF or Heinz Hospice, or you cleaned your closets while you were pretty good. Anybody do that? 8 o'clock, say, yeah, okay, yeah. Less clutter, and this one confuses me. Less clutter, more space. What in the heck's the space for? I always thought it was for the clutter, all right? One more. Less work, more play. Okay? Danny, you're into that right now, aren't you? Yeah. Did I leave anything out? Just the basics. Don't go spiritual on me yet, okay? But just the basics of what most of us think about. Did I leave anything out? I mean, it kind of covered money, house, food. And that's what most of our, am I right? That's what most of our resolutions center around? Well, today what I want us to do, as we think about this less, more lifestyle, I want us to think a little differently right now than what the norm is. Where I really want us to focus our attention today, and actually for the entire rest of the year, is I want us to think about less of me, more of Christ. Now, here's what I want you to do. I don't see, when I say things, I don't want you to sometimes take them literally. I'm not talking about less of me in your life. I'm talking about less of you in your life. Okay? So say with me, less of me, more of Christ. Let's do it all together. Less of me, more of Christ. You guys are sharp, man. You guys are good. And I think John the Baptist understood it the quickest. And in John chapter 3, if you want to turn there, John chapter 3, verses 29 and 30. Here's the deal. We got a wonderful computer geek back there, and she's now a very happy married computer geek back there, all right? And she's often going to put the scriptures up here, okay? And I think that's great, particularly for our guests. Okay? But for you regulars, bring your Bibles. Okay? Bring your Bibles. Tim, I can't read the print. Get a bigger print then, okay? But there's nothing better for a pastor than to hear the sound of what I'm hearing right now. Pages turn. Also, you need to stay familiar with the neighborhood. Okay? You need to know your way around this. Because it's not just for Sunday, it's for during the week as well. Okay? That wasn't part of the sermon. John chapter 3, 29 and 30. Listen to what John the Baptist said. I'm kind of cutting into the middle of his conversation, but he says, the bride belongs to the bridegroom. What John the Baptist is talking about here is Jesus Christ is the bridegroom. Those of us who have a relationship with Jesus, we're the bride. Don't take offense, men. This is just a relationship thing he's kind of laying out for us. He's using something they would understand. And then he says this, the friend who attends the bridegroom, what would we call that friend today? Best man, yeah, the best man. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him. And he is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. And John is now saying, that joy is mine. And it's now complete. Remember, he's Jesus' cousin as well. Remember, he got excited in the womb before his butt had been spanked yet. Okay? When Mary showed up, all right, and said, hey, I'm the virgin that got pregnant, all right? I've got the Christ child in me. And the scripture says, John the Baptist and the woman's mom leaped for joy. And he says, now that joy is complete. He, Christ, must become more, greater. I must become less. John the Baptist had this thing dialed in, didn't he? Me less, him greater. Paul also got dialed in on the same truth, and he wrote it from the perspective now of God's indwelling presence within his life in the person of the Holy Spirit. And in Galatians 2:20, if you want to turn there, that's to the right in your Bible of John, Galatians 2:20. Many of you have this verse memorized. But Paul said, I have been crucified with Christ. And it's no longer now I who live, but it's Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, on this world, how do I live it? I live it by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It was Major Thomas about 25 years ago who took this verse and put two words with it that made all the difference in my thinking from that moment on. He said, this is the great exchange. This is the great exchange. This is when my sinfulness is exchanged for his righteousness. This is when my weakness is exchanged for his strength. This is when my limited resources and ability are exchanged for his infinite resources and abilities. It's not me. It's Christ who lives in me. But what does this look like? Okay, Tim, John the Baptist understood it. Paul had this thing dialed in. What does that mean for me in real life in the 21st century? How is this less, more lifestyle expressed and how is it experienced? Allow me to make another less, more comparison list from a spiritual side of things to get our thinking going. And here's where you might start to use this piece of paper. I would suggest don't get in a rush. I'm going to give you 8 or 9 different less, more ideas. And God by His Spirit might drive 1 or 2 of those right into your heart and say, this is for you. Because what I want you to do, no, you're not going to turn these in. What I'm going to ask you to do is put that in your Bible. If you didn't bring your Bible, put it in your wallet after today. And I'm going to want you to visit that little piece of paper every month. And next December, I'm going to want you to get that little piece of paper out. And I want you to look at it, and by the function of God in your life, I want you to see if what you wanted to become less is less and what you wanted to become more is more. But here's some of the things. So just pick two or three, and maybe God will drive something that's not even on this list, but this is between you and Him. Am I making sense? Okay, let me give you a few ideas. How about less doubt and more trust this year? Less doubt, more trust. And here's a one-liner. I'm going to come back and visit this kind of right at the end. This is what woke me up at 1:48 this morning. Trust in God is evidenced by our obedience to God. Trust in God is evidenced by our obedience to God. I think this is what the guy meant when he said, I got in his grill. If you tell me that you trust God, but you do not obey Him, you are untruthful. You do not trust God if you don't obey Him. It's that simple. I grew up singing a hymn as a kid in church. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey. It starts because we trust Him, we'll obey Him. If we don't obey Him, we are only playing lip service to trusting Him. And listen carefully. I'm talking every area of your life. No reservations. How about less worry, more rest? Less worry, more peace. Whichever spin you want to put on it. The scripture says, cast all your cares upon Him. Not on your spouse. Not on your easiest going kid. On Him. Why? Because He cares for you more than any of the rest of us. Jesus gave a personal invitation when He said, come to Me. See, Jesus is already here. He's already come to us. And so what He now says to us is, hey, since I'm here, you come to Me with your burdens and your pressures of life. And when you come to Me with them, I will exchange them for rest for your soul. And remember, your soul is the mind you think with, the emotions you feel with, and the will you make decisions with. This is not a verse about a good night's sleep. This is a verse about contentment of mind and heart. How about less stuff, more ministry? Maybe this is what he meant by getting in his grill. If you look back over 2015, how much ministry were you engaged in? I'm not talking about how many worship services you attended. That's not ministry. I'm asking you personally, how much ministry were you engaged in? Tim, what are you talking about? Did you hear that somebody was in need and you went and you prayed for them? I mean, you didn't pray just from your house. You went to their house. You got into their space, and you took them by the hand, and you said, I want to pray for you. I'm talking about making a food dish because somebody can't for themselves, and you say, hey, I heard. I want to make life a little easier today. I'm talking about going to the store and buying a card because you know somebody's hurting. And you take the time to write a note and you put it in the mail and you mail it. You put a stamp on it. That's old-fashioned, I know. But man, email is so quick and so easy. I'm talking, you took some time. I'm talking about teaching a Sunday school class. Oh, pastor, I can't teach. I don't know. You know more than those five-year-olds do. It might be questionable about the six-year-olds, but you know more than the five. I mean, they've been to first grade, all right? You'd be surprised how many Sunday school teachers said to me, Tim, I cannot tell you how much I have learned teaching these kids. You've gone with a team to the rescue mission. You went on a mission trip. I mean, engaged in ministry. That's not just for the hitmen. It's not just for the paid staff. God calls all of us, if we're His children, to be engaged in His ministry. Coming that close to thinking I was dying this year, this has become a whole lot more serious to me, folks. This is not about holding your hand anymore. If you're visiting, I'll hold your hand all day long. This is about us together. 12 apostles turned the world upside down. There's more than 12 of us in this room. I'm not even asking for the world. How about just Clovis? Okay, Fresno, for you foreigners. Sure. Yeah. That's next door to hell, isn't it? I like Sanger. I'm sorry. All right, let me move on. Less TV, more time with family and friends. How about less newspaper and novels and more Bible reading? Let me ask you again, thought-provoking question. If you stacked up the newspapers and the novels you read this year and the time you spent reading those next to your Bible, what would it look like? I'm sorry to the B people here. I haven't bought a newspaper in a year. I read somebody else's, okay? But I don't hardly watch news anymore. Somebody tells me something's going on in the world, I'll Google just to find out what's going on because it got so horrible. And compare that to where you spent here. Tell me what you read in that romance novel or that Louis, and I love Louis L'Amour, or that Louis L'Amour book. And it's okay to do those, but you understand where I'm going? Did you spend more time there or here? Which one has lasting value? Which one has the potential for eternal change? How about less regrets and more contentment? Paul wrote from a prison cell with a busted up back, I have learned to be content in the situations I find myself. How about less silence? More witnessing. But Tim, I'm a silent Christian. Get over yourself. It's time to not be silent anymore. It is time to say, hey, I'm a Christian. I love Jesus. Well, I don't believe in religion. You know what? I don't either. Jesus doesn't either. Jesus came to have a relationship. Filled with the Spirit, I believe. Less fear, more courage. Less selfishness, more generosity. Less anger, more love. Less complaining, more praying. Less whining, more victory. Less foolishness, more wisdom. I'm going to give you, I did 2 minutes in the 8 o'clock service and it was too long. I'll give you 60 seconds of silence. Fill in your blanks. You don't have to fill them all in. Pick two, pick three. God put something else on your heart. Write it down. But write it down and put it where you will find it. 60 seconds of silence.
Okay, how is this going to be accomplished in our lives? If this less, more lifestyle is a desire of our hearts, how does this become reality in our daily experience? How do we prevent this dream from becoming just another broken resolution? I want to suggest to you today there's four steps in this process of this becoming reality in our lives. The first step in the process can start today. It can start right now. You see, it starts with a choice. It's not a desire. It starts with a choice. You can make that choice today. I want less, more. Less of me, more of Jesus. And these are the things I know He needs to work on in my life. That's a choice. Here's why it's a choice more than a desire. How many of you did not really want to get out of bed when your alarm went off this morning? Yeah, that was not the desire of your heart. Okay, you wanted to stay there, but you made the choice to get up. I woke up this morning at 1:48. I did not want to get, the desire of my heart was to roll over, go back to sleep. I rolled over. 12 minutes later, I said, this ain't going nowhere. And so I got up. I made my bed because I know Shelly would expect to see it made when she comes home tomorrow. I got ready, came to work. Wasn't the desire of my heart, but I made a choice. That's exactly what Joshua was talking about on his last public message to the children of Israel before he died. And Joshua said to the children of Israel, choose you this day whom you're going to serve. Don't put this off. The desire of your heart says you want to worship Baal and that Asheroth pole with all of her prostitutes. If that's the desire of your heart, then I'm telling you today, go over there and worship. But as for me and my house, we're going to worship the Lord who brought us out of our captivity in Egypt, who enabled us to survive its wanderings, and who literally walked us across on dry ground through the Jordan River and gave to us a land that flows with milk and honey. That's the choice that my family and I are making today. That's the choice you can make today. But after the choice, it begins to get more challenging with each step. Second step is it continues with consistency. What's the number one resolution around the world? Lose weight. Do you know what the number one failure of resolutions are around the world? Lose weight. Do you know why? Because they make the choice on day one, and about day four, they stop making the choice. There's not consistency to the choice. This is a choice that we make every single day. It continues with consistency in prayer. And guys, as I talk about prayer, I'm not talking about you talking to God. I am convinced that 95% of the prayer life in the world is us chattering away on a party line to God. And very few of us are listening to what God wants to say to us in prayer. We need to listen before we talk. Consistency in Bible study need to be in this book. 35 or 40 minutes on Sunday mornings is not enough. Scripture memory. You need to be memorizing key verses. You are not too old to memorize. Most of you who say you're too old, you know your four-number passcode for your phone. You know your pass for Google. You know your ATM code, all right, to get money out of the bank. You know your social security number. You can still learn some verses. It's never, never, ever too late for that. Consistency in worship. A week from tomorrow, January the 11th, churches all over Fresno and Clovis are talking about this today. And on January the 11th, I hope thousands of people are going to join together in this project. They're calling it a 21 days of prayer and fasting. I know some of you will find this slightly surprising, but I'm a bit of an odd duck. Okay. Maybe you don't find it all that surprising. I'm really big on the prayer part. I'm probably a lightweight on the fasting part. And here's why. If you choose to fast, don't tell anybody. Don't tell a soul. So it's kind of hard when you say, hey, I want all of you to go out prayer and fasting, because then we all know we're fasting. Jesus himself gave some direction on this fasting stuff, and he said, don't act like the hypocrite Pharisees. And when they fast, they put powder on their face to make them look sunken in and all drawn up so everybody feels sorry for them. No, he said, wash your face, comb your hair, go about business as normal, don't tell anybody. Because fasting is between you and God. And fasting can be food. There's all kinds of ways to fast, all right? I mean, some say you can call it Lent, okay? What are you going to give up for Lent? What this is really about, and to understand this, fasting is not designed so that God feels sorry for you so he'll answer your prayer. That's not what fasting is for. Fasting is excluding something that is time-consuming in your life that steals away devoted, concentrated time with God. And since most folks eat every single day, one of the things that they could eliminate for a period of time and give more attention in prayer is that. But hey, you know, fast from your hobby. Fast from the TV. If you're diabetic, man, don't fast, okay? Eat what you're supposed to, okay? But the idea of prayer for 21 days, I'm all over that. And if you want to choose something to eliminate, okay, here's one. For all of you gym rats, give up 21 days of going to the gym and pray. Okay, so pick something. Figure out what it is in your life. But okay, and I don't want to know if you're fasting, but next Sunday I'm going to ask, how many of you are going to join others of us around Fresno and Clovis to pray for your churches and your community? That's what it's for. Pray for your churches together and our communities together. So I'm going to ask that question next week. Okay, now, choice, consistency. Now, it gets more difficult. You see, it's maintained. This less more lifestyle will be maintained by accountability. Tell others of your desire and your choice. I'm not asking you to show me that piece of paper. But Susan, tell Danny what you put on that piece of paper, because he's going to be the one who's going to know most, more than anybody else. And he's going to want to clear his voice and say, Susan, bring that paper in your Bible. Okay? Tell your best friend. Tell your small group. Tell your people at work, hey, this is my commitment this year. I want less of this and more of this. And if you don't see that in me this year, you tell me. Hold me accountable. Here's why most of you won't do that. Because you want everybody else to think that you already are at the less more place in your life. The next step, this is the one that is so foreign. Star Wars! You have no idea. I've tried to go 3 times, and I haven't seen it yet. The very first one, I was in Nashville, Tennessee, saw it the first day, second day, third day it was out. Haven't even seen this one yet. Okay. Speaking of foreign, this last step in the process is going to be the biggest challenge for all of us. Choice, consistency, accountability. Here's the last one, and it's foreign. You see, this less, more lifestyle is only advanced to maturity by contemplation. You guys have no idea what I'm talking about, do you? 21st century America has no idea what contemplation is. That's not grunting in the bathroom, okay? That's a whole nother issue, okay? Contemplation literally means, from its Latin word, profound thinking about something. That's even foreign. Profound thinking about something. But from a biblical perspective, it's the state of beholding God and being in awe of our union with God.
You see, in Christianity, this refers to a content-free mind directed towards the awareness of God as a living reality. It's the practice. Here's the hard part for us. This is the practice of slow. Being quiet for 2 minutes in the 8 o'clock service nearly drove me nuts. Why? Because it was slow. But contemplation is a slow, thoughtful, savoring reading of the Bible and thinking about the God of the Bible. It's the way a pure golfer stands over a putt on a green and examines the distance his ball has got to travel. They're just focused. No rush, no hurry. It's the way a chef admires and salivates over a recipe that he knows is inspired. It's the way a carpenter gets when he feels a hammer that was just perfectly made for his hand. We're in awe. C.H. Spurgeon. Okay. In the last service, when I asked this question, just want to put you all at ease. 60% of the 8 o'clock service had no idea who C.H. Spurgeon was. Okay? So, if you're here and you know who C.H. Spurgeon was, raise your hand. You've heard, okay. If you're here and you have no clue who C.H. Spurgeon is, raise your hand. It's okay, because that's okay. See, it's vast majority. Okay. Here's what I want you to do, because I don't have time to go into great length. Google him when you go home today, not right now, when you leave, okay? When you leave, just C.H. Spurgeon, S-P-U-R. E-G-E-O-N, Spurgeon, yeah, G-E-O-N. In quick summary, he started preaching in his teens. He became a pastor of a Baptist church that was shrinking in London. At 22 years of age, he was preaching to 10,000 people every Sunday in London. Became known as the Metropolitan Tabernacle. He's probably the most prolific pastor writer in the history of the world. He's known in Bible college and seminary circles, those who've studied him. He's called the Prince of Preachers. I particularly love him because he smokes cigars. Hey. Spurgeon, I was waiting for the amen, all right? Spurgeon explains contemplation this way. Nothing will so enlarge your intellect. Nothing will so magnify the whole soul of a man as a devout, earnest, continued investigation of the great subject of deity. Deity means God. The most excellent study for expanding the soul, listen to this, is the science of Christ and Him crucified and the knowledge of the Godhead in the glorious Trinity. Don't most of us struggle with the idea of the Trinity? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, three gods. No, one God. Doesn't that blow your mind? Think about it. Don't just say, I can't get a handle on it. Contemplate it. Think of, if God wasn't so great that He makes you in awe of Him, find a new God. He's not worth your time if He doesn't put you in awe of Him. And the Scripture reveals to us a God that I can't help but be in awe of. The highest science, the loftiest speculation, the mightiest philosophy which can engage the attention of a child of God is the name and the nature and the person and the doings and the existence of the great God which He calls Father. There is something exceedingly improving to the mind in contemplation of the divinity. It is a subject so vast that our thoughts are lost in its immensity, and it is so deep that our pride is drowned in the infinity. So, how is this accompanied in our lives, accomplished in our lives? If this less, more lifestyle is a desire of our heart, how does it become real in our experience? Remember, four steps: choice, consistency, accountability, contemplation. So how are we going to do that as a church family together? I believe that the biggest book in the Bible holds some of the best keys for accomplishing that. What's the biggest book in the Bible? Psalms. What does the word psalm mean?
song, right? It's not complicated. I believe the songs of the Bible can help us. And so what I'm calling this year 2016, this is the year of the song at New Hope Church. Because you see, some of the issues that are covered in the biggest book of the Bible, it's got 150 chapters. Obviously, this year, I'm not going to preach out of every chapter. It would take me 3 years, only missing two Sundays a year, to preach the entire book of Psalms. But we are going to highlight probably 45 of them this year. And some of the issues, see if this isn't relevant. Some of the issues covered in the book of Psalms are compromise and the problems that come with compromising truth. How about uncertainty? How about the divine silence? Any of you ever wonder how come God is so quiet sometimes? How about worry? Any of you come with any worries today? Any of you have difficult people that you have to put up with? Live with? Don't say anything right now. Okay. Rephrase the question. Are any of you difficult people that others live with? Psalms talks about both. How about feeling overlooked, underappreciated? How about religion as a ritual? How about grief and sorrow? How about impatient arrogance? How about laziness? I'll give you about 2 weeks' notice. Get your kids here for that one. Okay. Imbalance and displeasing God. Just some of the subjects. Okay, I got to wrap this up. We all have those days when small problems become crises, when doubt begins to overwhelm our faith, when exhaustion hits and depression colors our world black. The fact is, this daily grind that we call life will not go away in 2016. And since you and I cannot escape it, we must find a way to live, some would say, beyond it. May I suggest to you, I want us to live above it. And the book of Psalms, I believe, holds the answers, offering words of surpassing strength and comfort for those difficult and those demanding moments in life. Just a few brief facts about the Psalms. Location, location, location. That's true in real estate, right? I think it's true about the real estate in Scripture. Do you know how many, do you know what the middle chapter of the Bible is? It's found in Psalms. It's Psalm 118, middle chapter of the Bible. Do you know where the longest chapter of the Bible is found? Psalm 119. It's the next door neighbor to the middle chapter of the Bible. Do you know where the shortest chapter of the Bible is found? It's the other neighbor, 117. 117 the shortest, 118 the middle, 119 the longest. Isn't that fascinating? Do you know how many chapters exist before Psalm 118? From Genesis chapter 1 to Psalm 118, do you know how many chapters there are? Come on, John, you got that right at the tip of your ear. You're a numbers guy. Yeah, you're absolutely correct. He's absolutely right. The number is 594. Now that you know that tidbit of information, how many chapters follow Psalm 118? 594, that's right. And if you add those two numbers together, 594 before, 594 after, what number do you come up with? 1188. 1188. Do you know what verse is the very center of the Bible? Psalm 118:8. Is that not lucky? And I would suggest to you that all of us need... Who snorted over here? That was good. That was cool. Oh, indeed, I love it. Actually, I remember that in college group. I forgot about that. That's what attracted Brandon to you those many years ago. That's good. We all need to get centered into God's Word, though, because do you know what Psalm 118:8 says? This is one you can memorize. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in a man. Pretty good for a middle verse, isn't it? Wow. You see, even in the most difficult times, trusting in God is at the center of His will for our lives. Remember I said earlier, trust in God is evidenced by our obedience to God. Trust starts with obedience for salvation. The Bible says, confess with thy mouth, the Lord Jesus. Repent of your sin. That's a command. It's not a suggestion. It's a command. And that's where it starts with us at the very beginning. It continues with directives about prayer. Do it without ceasing. Bible study. Do it day and night. Worship. Don't forsake it. Then trust progresses into our relationships with family and friends and our behavior with others. The Bible says, as commands, love one another. Don't covet. Don't steal from each other. Don't commit adultery with your neighbor's wife. Don't commit fornication. That means don't move in together without marriage. It's pretty clear. He tells us, do you trust him to do that? Or do you think you have a better plan that you can work things out? He says, hey, if you'll obey and trust me, I will prosper you. I will not harm you. Trust then advances to money matters. I suggest to you, tithe first. The scripture talks about the first fruits. Let God handle everything else. It talks about our work ethic. If you don't work, you don't eat. Give your employer an honest day's work. Talks about legal matters. Don't sue each other. Trust advances in the bad times, and it offers us hope. In weak moments, it gives us strength. In our sinful moments, it extends forgiveness. When we are sorrowing, it presents comfort. Trusting God in all areas of our lives is covered in the Psalms. Only eternity itself will reveal the number of untold hearts who have been comforted, and fears that have been removed, and feet that have been directed. Let me close with this. As a kid growing up, there was a song. It had one of those creative melodies that got in my head. And every now and then, this song invades my space. I've been known to sing it in the shower. I've been known to sing it in the car. I've been known to hum it sitting on a front pew. It comes at me at the most peculiar times. Here's the words of the first verse. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. Debbie already knows it. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. If you know the chorus and I start it, why don't you join me with it? All right, let's sing it. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. The next two verses say, I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. 'Twill be my endless theme and glory. With the angels I will sing. 'Twill be a song with glorious harmony, even me, when the courts of heaven ring. You see, that's a song that God has brought into my life at key moments. And the psalmist David and Moses and the sons of Korah and two or three others, Solomon, have put together the hymn book of the Bible. And it's called the Psalms. And if you learn them, God will bring them into your mind with a melody when you need them most. Let's pray. Our Father, less of anything and everything that gets in the way of more of you. May that be our prayer today. In Jesus' name, amen. So next week, read Psalm chapter 1. Read number 1.